lecture today in Democracy Rising called Film and Democracy, The Resisting Cinema. Can you hear me well? It's you and everybody. So, to the viewer, and that'll settle things for the viewers online. Yeah, it's kind of like we're living in parallel realities right now. The universe is probably fiddling with the many worlds interpretation of quantum mechanics. So we are delighted to have here today with us Masha Alyokhina from Pussy Riot, and we're also having Lindsay Alexanian, who is in Los Angeles right now. And we will be talking about our work and how it has been combined with the political developments, I guess, for the last years. To quickly introduce us, I'm a filmmaker and actor. Lindsay is himself a filmmaker and a producer. Masha is a political activist, and she's a member of Pussy Riot, and currently she's an advocate for prison justice and a lot more things, but we'll all have our time to discuss about our activities. I basically want to start by saying that I'm really happy, and this, in a way, is itself part of history of cinema. So the talk is democracy and film, but I don't want to be talking about the history of film. I would much rather talk about the present, because we do live in historic times, in a way. And this is New York, and the people who are here have been themselves creating art that is political. So I'll keep it personal. Let's all keep it personal, talking about our personal stories and work, and that will automatically and in itself be political. That's my suggestion for today. So Lindsay, you wanna give us a greeting and a hello from Los Angeles?
Yeah, hello everybody. Thank you for spending your time to listen to us. I really appreciate it. I'm really excited that Masha could join us. This is a bit of a momentous occasion for us, being that we made a film that we'll talk a little bit later on about, called The Penal Colony, about the experiences that that Nadia had when she went to a prison in Mordovia. I'm super excited to be involved with GCAS. I think that they're one of the most progressive educational institutions that exist worldwide, and it's a classless class. So I'm very very happy that I could. And thank you, Manos. I'm so sorry that I couldn't be there in person, but I really appreciate a brother being there to organize something so important and momentous as this. So thank you, everybody. And I'm sure that there'll be more that I can add to the conversation as it progresses.
And Masha, what brings you to New York?
I'm here. I came here to participate the exhibition, which is organized by my Russian friends, and Russian contemporary artists, religion, and it's called recycling religion. It's reflection and the position of religion, which we have now in Russia, and actually not only in Russia, mostly in, you know, East Europe also. When the place of religion is very hypocritic, and it's very close to government, and you know, in 100% actually patriarchs and and race and religion are used by political leaders to provide the ideas of these political leaders, and also religion used in politics. That was actually the main reason for us when we made a bank prayer in Pusarai Church. It's
Cathedral of Christ the Savior.
Yes, Cathedral of Christ the Savior. Yes, well, I'm here for this, but every time in New York you things to do, and I'm happy that I can speak with you, I can talk with you, and to a little bit also about my prisoners, and to tell you how prison system can work in countries like Russia when leaders don't want to how to say it, to change themselves to another leaders.
So I want to make a brief historic overview of the last 5 years. It's a brief history of time of the last 13.7 billion years of the universe. Like, what got me started in film and doing the film in a political way was I was in Athens, Greece, and the first memorandum deal was signed on June 2010. I had already begun making a film, but it was apolitical, right? And very soon after that, we started having the first austerity measures and feeling the pressure. And by the end of August, just 3 months later, basically, I had a very just tragic event in my life. And my mother committed suicide when she was 53. She was a political activist, and she was a school teacher and a poet. And that triggered something in me and convinced me that I had to convey her messages in my film, and I have to make the film political because that would continue her own struggle. And ever since I started caring more about politics, I just want to give you the data and the info that within the last 5 years of austerity measures in Greece, over 10,000 people have committed suicide. So that's like a war on people. Like, there has been an exponential decrease in suicide rates since the phenomenon wasn't existing before. And 10,000 people taking their own lives based on this pressure imposed by the Troika and by the European Union to a country like Greece is very telling, and is something we have to take into account about the world we're living in today, in the same way that we're taking into account the refugees and the unemployment and all these other aspects. Now, Lindsay was the person who encouraged me, and we teamed up, and we basically co-produced and co-directed the film that later became Red City. Red City got really tied up with the beginnings of the Occupy movement in Europe and in Greece. A year later, 2011, there was a second voting middle term deal for the bailout package for Greece that eventually led to the second memorandum. And on May 2011, in Athens, the first occupation of public squares started. We had the occupation of Sydagma Square in Athens, led to a two-month commune there that operated pretty much in the same way that Puerta del Sol in Spain and the squares in Madrid and Barcelona occurred. It was the wave that started in the Arab Spring, and eventually In Greece, it was crushed 2 months later with the immense police brutality. The deals were voted, of course, in the parliament. We were disappointed at the day. I was disappointed because a policeman broke my camera and arrested me for filming them, framing another citizen. So, you know, that was our general introduction to politics and to grassroots movements. I was in the multimedia team of Syndagma Square, and we did grassroots media activism, documenting, feed live everything that was happening, mainly the police brutality, but the beautiful things that happened there, the daily assemblies, the direct democracy there, for me, that's the most important thing. And so even though it was crushed in Athens, I was happy to see it later on, starting here in Wall Street, Occupy Wall Street, the universities all around the United States, like Occupy Call, and many other, like Oregon and so many other. And that's the end of 2011 and the beginnings of 2012. Mm-hmm. And me and Lindsay were still making Red City. That's an allegory, a poetic allegory about these things that we were experiencing. But and so the Western world is sort of resisting to austerity through the Occupy movement that was crushed by police brutality everywhere eventually, and here in New York. A lot of people ended up not in Rikers, but in custody, I guess, and was arrested. But Cecily McMillan was sentenced to eventually 2 months in prison, even though first they discussed about 7 years.
Yes, they discussed 7 years.
So that's what was happening here and gave birth to the film called Red City, and I will share with you the link. But in the meantime, we were also having stuff happening in Russia in 2011 and
2013, yeah. I think, yes. So
Putin wanted to be president again.
Again. So yes, the end of 2011, Putin told that he's going to the third term, and now I think all of us see what was happened after that. But we were the part of a big movement which started mostly in Moscow against this third term, and we called it Snow Revolution, and came to the main square with a protest. There were like about 100,000 people protesting against this third term, and after that we started to make our small political actions with songs. We made a song in the main square near Kremlin. It's called Putin Pissed Himself. After that, we made the action in the Church of Christ the Savior. And after that, they arrested us, and we were sentenced for 2 years of prison in Russia. After they gave us a sentence, they sent Nadia was sent to Mordovia, and I was sent to very north Ural Mountains. This is a kind of a special story with a town where my penal colony was. This is a small town, and it's famous for the holes in the ground. There are huge holes in the earth, and everybody is joking that this town is going to hell, straight to hell. Yes, so when I came to this penal colony, in Russia we don't have prisons, we have penal colonies.
What's the difference?
The difference is the prison is a building with the cells, and a penal colony is a Soviet, you know-how, and it's yes, it's like Gulag, so it's looking like a very strange with barracks, and all the people are living in these barracks. For example, women living, one group is 100 women, and they are all living together, sleeping in one room, going to, you know, two toilets and so on.
The Brigadia. No, that's for the...
Oh,
labor camps.
Labor
did
camps.
Did you have to work to sew?
Of course.
Yeah.
But I, from very beginning, when they sent me there, I refused to do everything and start to write about them, and they put me to solitary confinement for the half of the year. And but anyway, I
Wait,
can.
You were, like, in solitary for almost a half a year, or half?
Yes.
It's
very, you know, it's very usual for them to when you're protesting in Russia, they put you to prison, and when you're protesting in prison, they put you to another small prison. So it's, you know, it's their way of thinking.
How was it for you to be in solitary confinement?
I went to court against them, and I won, actually. And
congrats.
Like,
how long did it take you to win?
3 months.
So you were still in prison when you won?
Yes.
Okay.
So like 8 people were fired after that, but this the main guy from this penal colony, he was very angry because, you know, when you have problems like this, you lose all your money, all your, you know, status and so on. So they asked Moscow to put me somewhere else. So when they put me to another penal colony, which is closer to Moscow, and I spent there about 3 or 4 months, I think. But there I also started to have problems because, you know, the system is, we have only one system. In Russia, when they put you to this prison, to this penal colony, you have to sue, and people are usually suing police uniform. It's very cynical, because, you know, nobody
yeah.
likes police, and you have to sue police uniform. And when you refuse to do it, when you say that, fuck you, I will not do it, they start to make a pressure and to say about you that you are, you know, like they said about me, disorganizing their penal colony, that you are criminal leader and so on. But, you know, it's very, I think, funny to say about a small girl that she's a criminal leader. It's absurd. Anyway, after we were released, we started a human rights project to protect other prisoners, especially political prisoners. Number of them are growing from month to month. For example, they about 2 months ago, they arrested, for my opinion, main Russian artist, Peter Pavlensky, who burned the door of main Russian political police, FSB, which is, you know, update for KGB. Yes, so he burned their main door.
What is his name again?
Peter Pavlensky. And his first action was when Russian courts gave a sentence to us, he cut his mouth. Yes, you know, he really did it. So he cut his mouth against censorship and against our sentence. And after that, he made also several actions, and we think that he's really main Russian contemporary artist nowadays. And he's in jail now, and...
For how long? What's
his sentence? His sentence also, he up to 7 years, but courts now, the investigation is going on. Yeah. So it's in process.
Also, Unrest,
yes. Yes.
Jesus, this guy is insane. Awesome.
Yeah, no. He's really great.
Can you write to him when he's in prison?
Yes, I'm writing to him actually. For example, if I'm going somewhere, I'm writing a letter because
postcards,
it's
yeah.
Postcards. Yes, it's a little thing, but it's strange how it works in prison. You like fall in love with pictures from outside. It works much more better than, you know, regular letters. You just like to watch the pictures from different cities and so on. So, and we provide a legal help, like we're giving a lawyer to him. And not also not only for him but for another political prisoner.
We've generated international petitions with our faculty and getting momentum.
Yes, I mean it will be great. I think he will. Yes, he will appreciate it. And yes. So the problem is that. Usually, when you have kind of democracy in your country, people are protected not only in freedom, not only, you know, in their houses, but also in hospitals, in prisons, in all, you know, social institutes. But if you have government like our government corrupted, killing people and so on, people who do not protect it, they do not protect it twice, and that's why people are dying every day, like hundreds of people in Russian prisons, because they don't have medicine, they have to work for 14 hours, they, you know, and they don't have nobody just to write and to tell their stories. That's why we started to work with this problem, because somebody should do it. Yes.
So you're working through the Zona Prava
mm-hmm.
organization?
Yes, it's but Justice Zone, because Prava nobody understands.
Justice Zone.
Justice yeah. Zone. Yes, and.
Which you founded right after you were released from
mm-hmm.
prison?
Yes, after. And also we opened a media outlet, Media Zona, which now is one of the most popular media.
Independent, non-state-owned media in Russia.
Yes, non-state. But it's
Zona Media.
I mean, if you really want, if you are interested in doing political cinema or somehow connect with this, I think it's very important to go to places like Russia and to feel and to see by your own eyes how it's happening there. Maybe not to film there, but to understand how it is, because it's really different from news, from pictures, from everything. You can spend like 2-3 weeks and understand more than, you know, reading 20 books. For my opinion, maybe I'm wrong.
Masha, we have Gaza who's on Abdul Rahman.
Yes, I see.
Abdul Rahman. Hello.
Hi.
How's your is your microphone working, Abdul Rahman? I wonder if this microphone's off.
Maybe
okay. No, his microphone's off. Okay. This is hello. It's interesting to think about Russia and Gaza and to make some some connections there.
Yeah, there are now connections that can be drawn internationally with Greece, with Russia, with Gaza. In Gaza last summer, Israel, during the siege, they imposed calorie control. They controlled the amount of calories that got into the countries through food to feed its citizens. They put them on a diet, as they humorously said, the Israeli prime minister during the siege. That last summer, so summer 2014, the calorie diet. And this July, the European Union put Greece on a capital diet through the capital controls imposed when the democratically elected prime minister decided to just ask for a referendum, you know, the kind of referendums that are happening every day in Switzerland. Well, he thought it's a good idea to try it for once in Greece, and the country was put on capital control, and democracy was put on hold, and a coup d'etat occurred, and now there's no democracy in Greece anymore. So Greece has been turned into a debt colony. So from the penal colonies of Russia, we can now see the debt colonies of Europe, because the project obviously doesn't apply to Greece only, but to Italy, Spain, Ireland, and eventually, all of the Eurozone countries for sure. And Gaza is under siege, and we'd love to hear Abdul Rahman later if he can give us.
And also, maybe we can have Lindsay come in and give us an update of his work and what he's doing in LA.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, we're getting there. So now we're going to get into the penal colony film. And basically, what was happening is that Nadia published an open letter from prison called Why Have Gone on Hunger Strike on September 23rd, 2013. And I was really shocked when I read that letter. I knew that you were in prison, but I didn't know how bad things were. And I started following you more closely, and then Nadia was put in the Trans-Siberian, and everybody lost track of her for a month after her hunger strike. And that did it for me, you know, because like people were worried about her life, and as I was studying more and more about Pussy Riot and about your imprisonment, I felt that a need for a film was there to be made, not to just make a film or not, you know, to make a product or just to make art, but just to tell what was happening right then and there to the world from a very insider's perspective, and so we started making this film, and it was almost on a grassroots level. It was almost like people said, let's fucking do it voluntarily, let's go make this film, we don't have resources, but we'll find a way. Took us a few, we were hoping we would make it before you were released from prison, so before March 2014. Thankfully, you were released in December 2013, and started communicating. The actual film was able to be made almost 9 months later, after Lindsay joined us and then started producing and co-directing and co-writing. So we needed, Lindsay was in Los Angeles at that time, working in some big productions. But he would rather be working in this project. So he basically told a few people to fuck off, sold his car, sold his piano, and came to Greece to shoot the penal colony. So we're getting to what the penal colony is, but right before that, I want to say that influences for this film were the new techniques of guerrilla filmmaking that have been only made possible in the last few years, through a process that I think is a way of democratizing film itself. What are these elements? One is crowdfunding, obviously, and surely enough, you know, we've tried to crowdfund both our films so far. Another form is the simplification, the democratization of the means of production. Nowadays, you can edit in a computer, in a laptop. You can shoot with a DSLR camera. And that has made it possible for people to just go out there and make films in a way that wasn't possible before. And nobody, I think nobody did it better than the Russians in how you guys, through activism, political protest art, managed to really respond to political events. Just within a matter of days, often. First it was Vanya, with a completely radical performances, and then through Vanya, somehow some of the techniques of Pussy Riot emerged.
Yes.
Were you in Vanya?
Yes, somehow I was. I think best friend, and yes, she was a part of Vojna from very beginning, and she is actually singing on the all in the pan prayer and before and in Освobodi Prochatku. So she's a musician and also a political activist, and that's how I became like more involved in these groups. Yes.
You were studying philosophy at the time, or fine arts?
I was studying literature and journalism, and I started to work from 15. I was working at video magazine,
video club.
Yes, video club.
Oh, like Quentin Tarantino.
Kind of. And at one moment, I just realized that it's very strange that art is completely not connected with an activism, with life, with, you know, social issues and so on. And I started to organize ecological demonstrations and created a movement small, but was quite effective. And after that, I just realized that, you know, you have to combine arts and activism, because otherwise you will belong just to the one field, and this is not interesting. I mean, all this academic discourse, when it exists in university or at the museum, it's not working. Arts should work for people. That's how I like met Vojna, and we were very, you know, we lived a kind of similar lives. So that's how it was started. They were living in, you know,
occupied.
Oh, they were living in garage, actually, a very cold metal garage. And
what was that about?
It was very, you know, after kind of 2 years from that time when I first time met them, because, you know, this protest wave which we had it was very international, and we also wanted to be kind of international. That's why we choose an English name. And the symbol of, I don't remember, but anyway, the symbol of that time was anonymous protest mask. And we were very impressed by this symbol, and we wanted to create something to show that it doesn't matter who it is, you know, professor or business lady or, you know, student. It's important just what this person is talking about, what is, you know, shouting about. So that's why we choose balaclava and
color.
Yes. Everything was colored that time. I mean, it's not like now, unfortunately.
You mentioned the anonymous mask, and I want to connect it to its creator, essentially, in the public perception and imagery, Alan Moore, through his graphic novel V for Vendetta that was later adapted by Hollywood. And just to bring another example of the guy who, Alan Moore, he made those graphic novels. They were turning to big films like Watchmen or V for Vendetta, but he, in protest to Hollywood, so to the industrialization and privatization of film, he left America, he left Hollywood, he said no to millions of dollars as an exchange, just take his name off the end titles of some movies, and he went back to his hometown, Northampton in England, and that's where he stays now, and he makes films, short films with friends via crowdfunding. Our main influence, me and Lindsay's, was David Lynch. I became a filmmaker because I literally watched David Lynch's last film, Inland Empire, 3-hour, just hardcore experimental art house just trip. That was shot entirely with a cheap ass digital camera, standard definition, and at the same time, when, you know, his previous film, Mulholland Drive, was shot with a 35 millimeter, like impressive, just huge, beautiful, spectacular movie that you know. Shook and changed the paradigm. And so he made his last film with this digital camera, and then he stopped making movies. And then he started writing music, and then he started making, you know, YouTube videos with Moby and with his friends. And obviously devoted his life in transcendental meditation. But the fact that, because every revolution, and as Chris Hedges says in his book, which is highly recommendable. Every revolution needs the collaboration of people from the bottom and people from the top and people from all social classes and people from all backgrounds to work. You know, you can't just make a revolution just with poor people and just oppressed, or just with artists, or just, you know. So it's very interesting to see that people from the industry, well-established people like Alan Moore and David Lynch, made this journey from the top of the pyramid of the patriarchal hierarchy of imperialism and neoliberalism, down to the democratic grassroots new ways of doing art that crowdfunding and the digital tools, guerrilla filmmaking tools, provided. And at the same time, you got people starting from the bottom with no, you know, track record and work, using those tools to become more popular and well known, and this has been pivotal to all of our work and thousands of new artists' work. And in Greece, right before the uprising of 2011, we had the first fully crowdfunded documentary called "Deptocracy" by Aris Hazistefanou, who was in the Democracy Rising conference in Athens, who made this beautiful documentary and explained everything about austerity and everything about this whole debt crisis, and essentially nurtured nurtured our and my sort of political imagination. So I close this parenthesis, and now we return to the penal colony, and Nadia and Masha have just been released. We're trying to make in a movie. I'm in Athens, Lindsay is in Los Angeles, and I want to hear you, Lindsay, now saying how was that for you, and your narrative from there. We'll have to unmute you. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So that was
what?
Can you hear me?
Did you leave the cocktail parties and get fiddled with a bunch of dirty anarchists in Exarchia to make a movie?
So yeah, it was a strange experience for me being most would think that it would be strange being in Greece during that time. However, that time felt most natural to me. What didn't feel natural was the commercial and hierarchical structure of the Hollywood film industry, for which I was working in as a producer. And so I made the personal change sold my things and made some sacrifices in order to come to Greece and work on this film with Manos. The film immediately struck my interest as something that was something which was going to be able to affect people's viewpoints, that was going to be able to do what I believe cinema is meant to do, and that is to raise questions within the self. So to make a film with Manos that was going to be able to help people question their choices, question their world and their surroundings, which could possibly lead to an effect, was something that I wanted to dedicate my time to. So that was quite a long time of dedication. and as we learned, as I think all filmmakers know, it takes a long time and a lot of dedication to make it through the battle, which is the construct of the film. So I was so we got to Greece and we worked for months on developing this narrative film. And the more and more further away we get from the project, the closer we get to the completion of it, we start to realize how weird of a thing we actually did, because at the time it felt completely natural. We were just, you know, yeah, we're going to make a film about a true story, and it's going to be fiction, but it's also going to have some surreal elements. And we're just going to, yeah, we're going to take this thing that really happened and we're going to write a, you know, a fiction script around it. And what we were actually doing has not been done that much. It's what we ended up doing was emphasizing the core issues that were happening politically, but through the lens of a fictional narrative film. And that was really exciting for us. So one of the core constructs in the process, I think, was meeting was the first meeting that Manos had with Nadia before I even got involved on the project to kind of solidify
and Masha.
Yeah, and Masha, and then again, we managed to have through our lead actress Mariana Novak, we were able to have another meeting with Masha, Nadia, and Peter in Los Angeles.
Just so, Nadia and Peter this time.
So. your memory is much better. That's one of my downfalls. I have a very bad memory.
These 5 steps are just immense.
So we got information that we never thought that, well, that's not readily available online. We were able to have this information to be able to construct the story. And then once we had that, then we went through the process of creating the script together with Manos. And the outcome was unbelievable, bumpy, difficult. But the most important process is that we got it done. And I think that like making a film is very much like changing a policy, or very much like being placed into the context of a political situation within your country, which isn't necessarily right. And is difficult, and it's something that you need to change. You go through the process, and the process is very, very difficult. Requires a lot of sacrifice and constant commitment, and undenying and unwavering momentum and partnership. And I think that is kind of what kind of happened between within Pussy Riot. That's why especially within the core founding members of Pussy Riot, not Nadia, Masha, and Peter, you guys have had such a commitment to sticking with each other. And I think that's why you've been able to continue the momentum forward in changing the policies within your country. So,
Masha, Maxim Pastorovkin was also making a documentary about you guys.
He's my good friend.
He's amazing.
He's, I think I can.
We've met, he lives in Brooklyn, so we met a few weeks ago and we talked. Yeah. And I'd love to see him again. How long you're staying?
For 1 week.
Okay, so he said he'll be back on the 16th.
He's here now.
Oh, he's here, okay, cool. Yeah, that's the point. Mm-hmm. And how was it for you? My question coming is, how did you guys feel when you saw that some crazy guys from Greece and France are making a film about you? But before that question, how was it working with Maxim while you were in your trial and in prison, having his documentary throughout the conference in Maine? And later on, all the things that followed after you got released. How was the feeling? Because you were sort of incarcerated. At the same time, you were collaborating with filmmakers. And how was the feeling that your lives and what you're going through is actually being either documented or fictionalized eventually through the cinema?
At that time, we had completely, another problem. So, as I remember, our lawyers told us something like, somebody from the United States went to do a documentary. We said, okay, of course, why not? And that time, that was a time when they gave us a sentence and we were preparing to go to penal colony. And this is always stress. You don't know what to take with you and so on, what do not take, what books and so on. And we just, that was, at the end of the list of what we were thinking at that time.
Yeah.
And also, when we've seen it after release, we were. It's always strange when you see like yourself at the
screen.
Mm-hmm. Big, small. Big, small. Yes, screen. But Max is really a great person and I think good director and my friend.
And I consider you to be filmmakers too, because the videos you make are the same process. You shoot them, you edit them, you create them. And how has it been continuing after you released? You did the your first video after you got released was about the Sochi.
Yes.
At Sochi. And you were also arrested for that briefly.
Yes, can you speak about a little bit since you got there?
Yes, of course.
Talk about Sochi, you mean? So they will release us because of this Olympic Games, you know, Winter Olympic Games, which Putin decided to make at the most hot tropical city of Russia called Sochi. Yes, that was February, end of January and February of 2014. We decided to go there and to make a song, Putin Will Teach You How to Love the Motherland. We flew there, and just after 2 hours, they arrested us first time. And during next 2 days, they arrested us five times. And at the end of the story, when we, in sixth time, tried to sing just maybe 10 seconds or something near the banner of Sochi Olympics, there came a Cossacks, you know, a special Russian quasi-policemen with how you call them?
Whips.
Whips, yes, and started to beat us. And after that, they put us to hospital, but we ran from hospital and came to, you know, very conspiracy flat. And at one night, edit the video clip, which is based, you know, on the all of the things what was happening with us in Sochi. This is, you know, this is a story. And at the morning, we called journalists and we wanted to show them the song, you know, at some little, very, very small hotel. And we were, you know, we called the hotel and told that we will make a press conference there. They said, okay. And after they kind of understood what was happening, they called us back and said, you know, everything, something was, you know, broken, and we cannot, you know, let you in, as they usually do in Russia. And we made this presentation of the song at the front of this hotel. Yes, that's all.
And after I saw this video, I just we gathered a team, a small team in Athens, and we shot a protest video in your support in front of the Russian embassy of Athens, which was at the closing ceremony of the Sochi Olympics. And so, yeah, we had like the LGBTQ flag. If you remember, and the people just imposed riot masks. They just did the Black Panthers fist. So how did you feel when you heard the, you know, that a few crazy folks in Greece are trying to make a film about being Italians? Did you think that, okay, these guys are just crazy? Or did you think that, okay, these guys are just crazy, but let's see what they can make, you know? Because they're.
I was impressed because, you know, you came and you met us. You came to Moscow, and just not so many people are doing this, and. I was also impressed that you want to do something about Russian prison, because it's, you know, it's very rare that somebody want to make a movie, and especially a fiction movie about Russian prison. This is, but I was sure that you will do it, and you did.
Thank you for believing. You know, there's this saying that says, leap and the net will appear. So it did eventually, and Lindsay wrote it with him, fishnet from the Pacific Ocean. And so I was really surprised by the fact that no more films were made about. You're saying that you're surprised for somebody wanting to make a film about Russian prisons. I was surprised that nobody from, you know, Hollywood or any of those people who have access to the more resources in the industry didn't make a film ever about you. And it, while we were trying to make this film, being like on a no budget, like low to no budget as we usually are, I was just counting, like every day I was thinking, okay, checking IMDb, you know, is there a film being made about Russian prisons, about your story, about Nadia's story? And it took, that was February 2014. It took until February 2015, 1 year for House of Cards to finally make, not a film, but a TV series episode about Russian prisons. And they got you guys in the episode. Mm-hmm. And how was that? How did that happen?
Accidentally. We met here in New York. There is a Penn Center, the center, the organization, literature organization, and they invited us to the ceremony. And there we met Paul Willimon. We didn't know who he was when he asked that I know you and you know about Russian prisons. We answered yes, and he invited us to, and he said that he's a screenwriter for House of Cards, and he invited us to screenwriter's room, and for maybe 4 or 5 hours we were talking about the conditions of Russian jails, and at the end of the story, he just said that we want to invite you to House of Cards, and we were very impressed because we are fans, of course, of the show, and we think that it's most interesting and best made political shows now. And that's how we start to work on it. After some months, we came to Baltimore where they have production, and made it.
Were you satisfied by the result when you watched the episodes?
Mm.
To what extent, like, do you feel that something could have been different? Were you really, really happy with it?
They count every detail, so you cannot, I think I cannot analyze the result because I was very, very inside. And but what I can say, this is most, I think, impressive and big production I ever seen. They are really taking care of every, you know, place of every plate.
Exactly, yeah.
Yes, and what is interesting that the director is not a main figure in the show. If you see, they change a director every series.
Yeah. First it was David Fincher, and then Kevin Spacey, has he directed yet?
They are like gray cardinals. They really, they making decisions, and director, this is completely not main figure there. All the decision about concepts, about style, is made by Fincher and Spacey.
Yeah. And then come the screenwriters.
And the main screenwriter is Bo, actually. Yeah. They have a room of screenwriters, but decision maker is Bo. And he's really great. He's, I was so impressed when I spoke with him. You know, politics, Russian politics, more than any Russian. He knows that he knows by memory a lot of Chekhov dramas. So yes, he's wonderful. Maybe that's why they have so good drama lines.
And how do you see things now in U.S. film and television? Are they turning more political in a way? Do you see any changes that are favorable as a wave of after House of Cards?
House of Cards, I think it's quite a unique thing. Maybe I don't know so much about U.S. film production, but
in Russia, do you have the
in Russia we do
films or series?
Leviathan, about Leviathan, I think you heard the film of Zyagintsev, which was nominated to Oscar last year.
Yeah, Leviathan. Yeah, we wanted to see it, but we haven't seen it yet. It was banned in Russia? Something.
It was not banned in Russia, but all the journalists and critics were told not to write nothing positive about this film. And I mean, it's a shame because there are no films nominated to Oscar from the 80s in Russia. So they had to be proud about this film, but unfortunately they were not. Mostly when somebody in Russian cinema field decide to do something about politics, it's an independent directors, because all the budget is going to making films about how great Russia was in the Second World War or something like this, that. And it's nobody gives you budget to making political show.
I've noticed here just from being in New York, there are some films now that are that have been made and released, like there's Brooklyn, there's 33, there's Chirac made by Spike Lee that was released today, I think, this weekend, that are actually political in a way or the other, especially Chirac. It's made to basically talk about the gun violence and the brutality in the black community in Chicago. Mm-hmm. And so Chirac stands for CHI for Chicago, and then Iraq, talking about a slow sort of war and genocide that's been unfolding there. And and also the it's based on Lysistrata, which is an ancient Greek comedy about women going on sex.
Favorite, yes.
Yeah, feminist, obviously. And so it's so funny that he put Lysistrata in Chicago, so the leading protagonists in this movie are black females, so non-rich and non-male protagonists, which is really cool in itself. And I'm hoping that this is kind of a trend now, you know, just that filmmakers, even in the United States, advocating some cause through their film or making films to address, you know, the 99% rather than the 1%. But what do you think, Lindsay, like being in Los Angeles, now, have you noticed any change from just the previous summer that you were there?
microphone.
Hi. Yeah. Sorry, the mute thing. Well, I think I've changed, you know, life changed me as a, you know, as a maker. And so, yeah, I have a lot of issues with the way that, that the world is functioning. I have a lot of issues with the way that the film industry functions. The reason why people, and I'm using a lot of generalities, but I think that there's a lot of things to uncover still in the world and to bring to light, and I think it all comes down to human nature, and why people are the way that they are, why people tend to create borders and boundaries and, you know, secularisms and tribalisms, why they associate and congregate into one group or another. I don't understand a lot of it, and I guess what I try to do as a filmmaker, or what I kind of use film to do, is to make, to answer those questions, to help me answer questions. That is it. That's all I do. So I don't understand. I can't possibly conceive the idea as to how somebody could be put into a predicament like Nadia, Masha, and so many others have been placed into, being put into the penal colony. I also can't understand how a majority of people in the world think that correctional facilities or this idea of prison is going to help better our society. That's a question that that's a bigger question. I don't understand how, if you put somebody in a box, a guy in a box who has a problem, and then you put like 10 or 15 or 20 other people that might or might not have problems, how those people are going to be able to better each other, repair each other, and then contribute back to society so we have a better place to live in. I think that that's absolutely ridiculous. I think it's just like, so a majority of the world, I feel, is lunacy. That's where I'm at. And maybe I'm a little bit mad, you know, to be able to see the madness, but I film is about the only medium that I can explore deeply questions that I have about these issues. And Los Angeles sucks. I hate it. It's completely a capitalist, it's completely a capitalist society, which I don't agree with so much, you know, but it's okay. It's okay.
You see, Lauren, right before we go to the students' Q&A, I also wanted to ask Masha what she's been working on now. I also want to mention that Matla is here. Did I pronounce it correctly? And they did together a great song called I Can't Breathe as a response to Eric Garner's murder by the U.S. police last summer.
A great song. I love
yes,
it.
We were just impressed at protests which were in New York that time. That was December of 2014. We were here and we've seen this protest, and I mean, it's quite in Russia there are no protests now, and here people were going every day to streets, blocking, you know, police cars because of the death of one person whom nobody knows. And we were so impressed by the story that, and we made this song, which is dedicated to Eric Garner, but also for all the people who were killed by police state and by police in United States, in Russia, and just, I mean, suddenly after after 2 weeks, we were released. The song of the main oppositional leader of Russia was killed near the Kremlin walls. And yes. So
Boris Nemtsov,
yes. And for us, it's very important to put attention to the situations. I think it's our responsibility, like as a political activist and social figures.
It's very shocking for me how the people present here are so involved within the recent international politics and history, and their art and their lives are identical, like and like Masha went to prison for work, just for singing a song in the church, and we have Boris Nemtsov assassinated in front of a Kremlin. That happened how many?
It was 28th of February.
28th of February,
this year.
2015. When I went to meet Masha in Moscow last February 2014, there was a big demonstration against the invasion of Ukraine by Russia. And in this demonstration, Boris Nemtsov spoke, addressed the people, and I had the opportunity to see him along with Nadia and Masha. And it's crazy that he got killed. And all this stuff is happening. So. I'm so shocked by the price an artist has to pay in order to be free, in order to be vocal, and in order to be political. And we also see that, obviously, not just with artists, but we see that with people like Edward Snowden, who are imprisoned, and for just advocating democracy, for practicing democracy, And the latest thing I've heard is that you, Masha, went to a refugee camp.
Yes, I've been.
Czech Republic. Yes.
It's no Czechoslovakia anymore. yes, I've been in refugees camp in Czech Republic, and it's, you know, the Czech president is one of the main friends of Putin, and he's very, you know, he's asshole actually. He always go to journalists, to TV and to radio drunk, and he supported Putin, and he supports, you know, every crazy idea which Putin have. So I came, I was invited to this refugees camp by volunteers who are helping refugees there. And what was really shocked that the guards who are working there, of course, they were not happy that we came. But you know, when one guards are going home and another guards are going, you know, to the work, they had a really strange, like, a sign to, you know, to say hello to each other that was completely, you know, Nazi sign. They do this, and we said the same. We said the same when we seen it, and the conditions of these refugees are really strange. I mean, they don't give them any information in their language. They give all the information in Czech language, which nobody knows except them. And they don't have any access to air. They don't have, even in Russia, in prisons, but have an access to 1 hour of walking, you know. It's very strange, but anyway, we have it. At in this camp, they have to be in this, you know, four worlds for several months, and they completely don't know what will happen with them. And after New York, I will go to, I was invited to also to the refugee camp in Calais, France. I think it's important to put attention to refugees and also to minorities' discourse, especially now when the ultra-right parties, political parties,
extremely right-wing parties.
Yes, as we know, in France, Marine Le Pen now is, you know, the main figure, and I think it's quite terrible, because it's going to the situation which we had at the beginning of 20th century, and it's not so good.
So we can turn to the questions of the audience. Creston, would you like to start with the questions in written form or?
Sure. Yes. to come up here so they can.
Oh my God.
There's some questions here.
I see it.
But feel free, those of you who have microphones, why don't you just ask your questions? I know, Rosie, do you have your microphone engaged? It doesn't matter if your video is not there.
Oh, yeah, I think I do. Is that working?
It's working.
So, I mean, the first question I had was kind of for everybody, because I'm curious about the prisons in Russia. And I'm wondering if the, like, in labor, so prisoners in the U.S., there's been a lot of controversy over prison labor being used to produce dairy products and being sold in Whole Foods. And I'm wondering if, I mean, and prison labor being used for commercialized interest is not uncommon here. So I'm wondering how prisoners' labor is exploited or used in Russian prison camps. Like, were you expected to do work for commercialized purposes or even governmental purposes?
So how is labor used in prison camps in Russia? Is it used to for commercial ends?
I don't think that it's used for commerce, but it's mostly used to make cheap labor to produce police uniform and uniform for Russian army. That's how they. I mean, yes, it's very common. If you know the story about Crimea, how they occupied Crimea with, you know, these polite people in a green uniform. So this green uniform is made 100% by prisoners of Russian colonies. Yes, mostly by free, because they pay nothing. It's kind of $2 per month. These green people were dressed by prisoners. That's all. They don't know how to put it more commerce. If they knew, I'm sure they will do it.
Oh, I remember you mentioning that earlier about the uniforms. Sorry.
Jamie, you had a question. Amy Sacker, you had a question you had posted. Would you mind coming on? Oh, no microphone. Okay.
I'll try here. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, it's great.
Yeah. Oh, great. I don't have a headset, but I was really curious if there's any thought on the philosopher Alexander Dugin, who allegedly is an influence to Putin, and he's embracing that Eurasianism. Is, you know, are thinkers like the Eurasianists of any real influence, or are they more just kind of a sideshow for the powers that be in Russia?
So you're curious if Dugin is popular in Russia, as I understand. All this Euro-Asianist discourse, they start to popular to make popular during the Crimea situation, because they had to explain somehow why they during the occupation. I don't think that it's popular, because I mean, unfortunately, not so many people needs on the explanation of what Russian politicians are doing. They just accept it or not accept. And people who are accepted this militarization and unites or like this they want to, you know, to build another Soviet Union, quasi Soviet Union, and people who are support this this political line, they support it because they just like this Soviet concept, not because Dugin created this modern Euro-Asianist, you know, it's, I don't think that it's popular.
Thank you, very interesting.
I have a,
with girls, so we have this anti-abortion propaganda at one side, and in another side, they don't do nothing with girls who decide to make to have a baby. Mm-hmm. For example, they give as a social, they give about $30 per month for the girl who decide, you know, to have a baby. It's nothing. This is completely nothing. And I started to read about social politics in Russia. I started to, of course, to go to press conferences of politicians who were discussing this. And at the, after some months, I just realized that, I mean, they completely, they are assholes. They're stealing money, they're corrupted, and this discourse, this conservative discourse, which they create day by day, it's completely, you know, it's something for with what I have to fight, because yes, and I was a volunteer at a psychiatric clinic where girls are, and they are not, you know, they don't have, mostly of them, they don't have, they are not sick. They are just, they are from this kids' houses, you know?
Yeah.
And they, yes, and they were just, you know, they are uncomfortable for administration of these kids' houses, and they put it to the to the psychiatric clinic, and then
they took them there. They didn't choose to go there.
Yes, they just to punish them, like, you know, like Russian government put somebody to prison to punish, and the medicine, this aminazine medicine, which is banned in United States, in Europe, everywhere. This is medicine which was used for, you know, in Soviet Union to punish, you know, political prisoners. They use it for 15 years girls. Yes, and that was also quite terrible. I've seen not only these clinics, not only abortion situation, but some other things, and somehow I realized that I should do something. That's all.
So would you say that abortion issue is probably your main conflict with the Orthodox Church?
Yes, the not only Orthodox Church. We have crazy
American.
I think if you are a politician and you provide this anti-abortion discourse, you have to have a really strong explanation. But they don't. They completely don't, and at the end of the story, we have a lot of children in the kids' houses. And of course, government do not give any money for these houses. Children dying there, and maybe you've heard about this law,
right.
Children, which they create, that's, you know, people in the United States.
Is that just the US or the other?
Europe and US.
Sorry, I'm technical. Did you go to Masha Alyokhina? Are you familiar with the...
No.
Because I know right now, I'm looking at demography there. Department of demography.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the abortion.
Right.
That's a fact question.
And they discuss now the law, you know, which, you know, if they sign it, abortion will be really, you know, difficult in Russia. So yes, and I think on another important, once all the women in penal colonies, they are there because of the domestic violence, and we don't have in Russia completely social mechanism for protect women in the domestic violence, and that's how, you know, crimes are happened.
Masha, we have a question by Duncan. About what is your main criticism of the Russian Orthodox Church, and do you see any good in it? I also wanted to ask you about that, retrospectively after your performance in Christ's the Savior Church. How do you respond? So Dongan's question is, what is your criticism of the Orthodox Church? I want also to ask you, what is your response to the criticism you've received about that performance? Because, I mean, you were put in prison about it, but you had all this criticism that you were being blasphemous, mm-hmm. and you did hooliganism, mm-hmm. and that you insulted the feelings of millions of believers. Mm-hmm. You know, you hurt those people. I've been hearing it like from all over the world, like, oh, if these girls were in an Islamic country and they did that in a mosque, they would have killed them right then and there. I've tried to explain that actually you were let free to go, to leave the church. You were not arrested for the actual 42nd gig. What they did was that you made the video, and the video became viral. Mm-hmm. And then Syria, the Archbishop?
Syria?
Who was the name? Kirill.
Ah, Kirill.
Kirill, probably, I don't know, maybe
Patriarch
made a phone call to Putin saying, you gotta do something about it. But, well, obviously, this is not what happened. But how do you respond to the criticism you've received of that?
At first, this Patriarch Kirill is, you know, he owns a tobacco business. He have a business inside this Church of Christ the Savior. They have, you know, you can wash the machine, you can rent some halls for your corporate dinner, for the banquet, you can invite musicians there, girls, or what you need. They don't have to pay any tax for this business because they are church. And this church, actually by law, belong to fund. And this inside this fund are not only people from church, but also a chief of Russian, of Moscow police, actually. So Russian, Moscow police somehow own this Church of Christ the Savior. I think, of course, they didn't arrest us, but when all the people who owned the church knew what was happening, they seen the video and they were, I think, quite upset about this criticism. This chief of Moscow police, next day, first policemen without any police uniform, of course, came to my flat and wanted to arrest me. But I was very lucky because I was with my son. I've told them that, I know nothing with me. I mean, what girls, what church, I don't know what you're talking about. And they left. And this night we decide to run away because we realized that after some days that they will open a criminal case. And they did, actually. And after 1 week they arrested us. But the main point is that Patriarch and Russian Church is not actually not only and mostly not a religion organization. This is a real political power, mm-hmm. which is provide political issues to people. Patriarch told that two Christians should not go to anti-Putin demonstrations, but should pray in their flats. And this is political statement was made in this cathedral. And at this point, we understand that they use the cathedral as a political platform. So if they use, we can also use, I think. And that's all.
That's democracy.
Yes, this is, you know, alphabet of democracy.
Are women actually allowed to be in the altar?
Women are not allowed to be inside the altar, but women, of course, allowed to be in the, at this green carpet,
yeah,
where we've been by religious law. But that was a kind of one of the main points of discussion in the court. Are women allowed to be at a green carpet at the front of the altar or not? And in the Russian Orthodox Church, we don't have women priests, and we are sure that we should have them. Why not? I mean,
can I ask something?
That's all.
Any more questions? Do you have a question?
Yeah, please. Helen.
Just from the audience here, Creston.
You
could you replace me in this chair for 1 minute?
Oh, sure.
So you said when you were preparing.
And so about your experience as a refugee.
What books did you
do? Oh. How did they help you? I actually had a small library with me, so I was very... I took football. I took some Russian poetry from avant-garde, maybe Obudensky.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, they are my favorite. And Bob Black, he's a U.S. activist and left, you know, his book. Yes, but the thing is that they sent me to this Ural Mountains, and the way up, I don't know if you know this, the way from Moscow jail to penal colony took 1 month.
What?
So, yes, 1 month.
Did you walk there?
No.
Backwards?
Do you know Stalipin wagons?
No.
No?
Tell me.
It's a special wagon which they... At the end,
oh, like a van that they put prisoners in.
Yes.
Like a bus.
No, it's not like a bus. It's a train wagon.
Okay, yeah, train car, yeah.
Not train car. It's a Stalipin wagon.
It's
Italians know how, but nothing in this, in the way of way to prison, nothing changed. So it's a special.
Oh my God.
They don't have.
It's humiliating.
Windows. It is. They don't have windows. They don't have, you know.
Well, I know cattle car. We call these cattle cars. Like it's like what they put cattle in. Like there's no windows.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yes.
This is what we call cattle cars.
But it's not a car.
I know, but we use this expression.
Okay.
We know it's not a car, but it's like a box where they would put livestock or animals in, because there's no windows or anything.
Kind of. Yes.
Okay. Something similar.
Yes. And inside it's separated to small boxes. And inside one small box, usually they put 12, 13 people. So
Jesus.
In this wagon, you're going to one, you know, time jail in one city. You spend there some days, and after they put you again to wagon, and you put to another jail. And after that, they put you again to the wagon, simple, and put you at the penal colony. So it takes 1 month, and you're not allowed to call, to write, to contact with nobody. So that's how what Manas was told about Nadia. She kind of lost. She didn't lost. You know, it's a standard for everybody. So for example, when they put a Nadia was transported by a special car to Mordovia because it's, you know, it's not so far from Moscow. But for me, it was not possible. So they put me to the standard.
Oh my God!
Wait, and when I first time seen this penal colony, it's kind of minus 35 November, snow, and I never. I've never been in places like that. I mean, of course it was hard, but I was really shocked because it's you reading from your teenage years, you're reading Solzhenitsyn's Shalom, and now you see it by your own eyes, and you are like, it's...
Was it like super surreal to you? Like, did it take your a lot of the time for your mind to get around it? Did you have like nightmares? Psychologically,
you don't have, you know, you don't have time for nightmares there. You don't have time to sleep, actually. The first thing which you feel is cold, and second, that you want to sleep, and you don't allow to do it. And they don't have hot water there, actually. So it's my
so your hands are freezing all the time from the water.
Yes. And your hands stop becoming white, they becoming red, and with this...
And did your fingernails start cracking? Like,
uh-huh.
Because of dehydration, because
yes.
You're not going to drink water because it's so fucking cold.
Yes.
So you get dehydrated.
Mm-hmm.
One of our Duncan, one of our researchers, Duncan, asks, he's coming from England, have you ever read Brothers Karamazov, and what do you think of Dostoevsky?
Братья Карамазовы?
Yeah.
Of course.
And what do you think of Dostoevsky in general, in terms of, you read literature?
Yes.
And he's, of course, a dominant figure in Russian lit.
Yes.
What do you, how do you relate to this character, this guy? Frodo Dostoevsky. Theodore.
It's interesting because he was also a part of political circle, and he was up to, how to say it, when the government decided to kill him.
Mm-hmm. The firing squad, death sentence. Death row or something.
Right. And he was, at the very final, he was, they didn't do it. That's how I think he started to, he understood that he's a writer, and he showed that sometimes literature can live more than political circle. And
that's amazing.
I mean, I don't know what to say about what I'm thinking about him, because you know it's with whom you are kind of living your life. It's part of culture. And yes.
Well, thank you very much, everyone, for joining us today. It's really just a super pleasure to have Manos and Lindsay, and of course Masha and Matthew, for joining us today. Thank you for coming in from Gaza and from all over the world. We're going to pick this up next week. Our final talk will be from the Stanford professor in economics, Richard Wolff, or former Stanford professor, Richard Wolff. Do you know Richard Wolff? He's a kind of radical economist. So that'll be next week. And we're hoping to have Masha and Matthew be part of what we're doing. Part of what we're doing in the future with Micah White, he started Occupy Wall Street, and so many others who are part of what we're doing. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
It's really great. Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay. Wow. That's amazing. I'm going to stop recording could you stop recording on my computer, Sigrid? Thanks. And do you have time? You don't have time.